Welcome to the Chapter 11 lecture, Behind the Supply Curve, Inputs and Costs. This chapter will lay the foundation for our analysis of market structures. It is very important to understand the costs of a firm before determining profit maximization for the various market structures.
The production function. The production function shows the relationship between the quantity of inputs used to produce a good and the quantity of output of that good. The production function can be represented by a table, an equation, or a graph. For example, Farmer Jack grows wheat. He has 5 acres of land and can hire as many workers as he wants. Let's look at Farmer Jack's production function as a table and a graph. L stands for the number of workers, Q stands for quantity, in this case, bushels of wheat. On a graph, quantity of output is on the vertical axis, and labor, or number of workers, is on the horizontal axis. When there are 0 workers, quantity is 0. 1 worker can produce 1,000 bushels of wheat. 2 workers can produce 1,800 bushels of wheat. 3 workers can produce 2,400 bushels of wheat. 4 workers can produce 2,800 bushels of wheat. And 5 workers can produce 3,000 bushels of wheat. Marginal product. If Jack hires 1 more worker, his output rises by the marginal product of labor. The marginal product of any input is the increase in output arising from an additional unit of that input, holding all other inputs constant. Just a note here, the triangle stands for delta and means change in. Delta Q means change in output, and delta L means change in labor. The marginal product of labor, or MPL formula, is delta Q divided by delta L. Let's calculate marginal product. The number of workers changes by 1 unit and the quantity of output changes by 1,000. Therefore, the marginal product is 1,000 bushels. Again, the quantity of labor changes by 1 unit and the quantity of output changes by 800. Again, the quantity of labor changes by 1 unit and the quantity of output changes by 800, so the marginal product is 800 bushels. You continue using the same formula to fill in the rest of the table. Marginal product of labor is the change in quantity divided by the change in labor. Why is the marginal product of labor important? Remember another principle from Chapter 1. Rational people think the margin. When Farmer Jack hires an additional worker, his costs rise by the wage he pays that worker, and his output rises by the marginal product of labor. Comparing the wage and the marginal product can help Jack decide whether he would benefit from hiring the worker. Farmer Jack's output rises by a smaller and smaller amount for each additional worker. Why? Well, as Jack adds more workers, the average worker has less land to work with, and he will be less productive. In general, marginal product of labor diminishes as labor rises, whether the fixed input is land or capital. Diminishing marginal product is the concept that marginal product of an input declines as the quantity of the input increases, other things equal. Farmer Jack must pay $1,000 per month for land, regardless of how much wheat he grows. The market wage for a farm worker is $2,000 per month, so Farmer Jack's costs are related to how much wheat he produces. Looking at his costs on a table, the labor and quantity we've already reviewed. The cost of the land stays fixed and was $1,000 at all quantities. Each each worker costs $2,000, so labor costs go from 0 to 2,000 to 4,000 and so on. Total cost is the sum of the cost of land and the cost of labor. Total costs start at 1,000, 3,000, 5,000, and so on. Let's look at Jack's total costs on a graph. We can focus on the relationship between quantity of wheat and total cost. Costs are on the vertical axis and quantity is on the horizontal. Marginal cost, or MC for short, is an increase in total cost from producing one more unit. The formula for marginal cost equals the change in total cost divided by the change in quantity. When calculating marginal cost, it's very important to calculate the change in quantity and the change in total cost. As quantity changes from 0 to 1,000 and total cost change from 1,000 to 3,000, marginal cost equals $2. As quantity changes from 1,000 to 1,800 and total cost changes from $3,000 to $5,000, marginal cost equals $2.50. You would use the same formula to fill in the rest of the table. Marginal cost can be illustrated on a graph, with marginal costs on the vertical and quantity on the horizontal axis. Why is marginal cost important? Farmer Jack is rational and wants to maximize his profit. To increase profit, should he produce more or less wheat? To find the answer, Farmer Jack needs to think of the margin. If the cost of an additional wheat, the marginal cost, is less than the revenue he would get from selling it, then Jack's profit will rise if he produces more. There are two types of costs, fixed costs and variable costs. Fixed costs, or FC, do not vary with the quantity of output produced. For Jack, his fixed costs are $1,000 for his land. Other examples of fixed costs might be the cost of equipment, loan payments, or rent. Variable costs, or VC, vary with the quantity produced. For Jack, his variable costs are the wages he pays the workers. Another example would be the cost of materials. Total cost, TC, is the sum of fixed costs and variable costs. Let's go through a second example that is more general and can apply to any type of firm producing any good with any type of inputs. Here we have a table of data with Q for quantity, FC for fixed costs, VC for variable costs, and TC for total costs. On a graph, costs are on the vertical axis and quantity is on the horizontal axis. Fixed costs will be represented in blue, variable costs in red, and total costs in green. Quantity goes from 0 units up to 7 units. Fixed costs are costs that do not vary. In this case, fixed costs are $100 for all leveled output and is drawn as the horizontal blue line on the graph. Variable costs vary as output varies. Variable costs start at 0 when output is 0 and increase up to $520. Variable costs are shown as the upward sloping curve red line. Total costs are the sum of fixed costs and variable costs. Total costs start at $100 and can increase up to $620. Total costs are shown as the upward sloping curve green line. Next is marginal cost. Remember, marginal cost is the change in total cost divided by the change in quantity. I suggest that you take a moment to pause the lecture and check if your calculations of marginal cost are correct. Marginal cost starts at $70, falls to $40, and rises back up to $140. On a diagram, the marginal cost curve looks like a J. Next is average fixed cost. Average fixed cost is fixed cost divided by quantity. Since we cannot divide by zero, there is no possible answer for AFC at zero quantity. I suggest pausing the lecture and calculating average fixed cost on your own to make sure you can do the calculations. Average fixed costs start at $100 and decrease to $14.29. On a graph, we can see that the AFC curve starts off high and gets closer and closer to the horizontal axis. Average variable cost, or AVC, is variable cost divided by quantity. Again, we cannot divide by zero, so there is no possible answer for zero quantity. I suggest pausing the lecture and calculating average variable cost. Average variable cost starts off at $70, decreases to $52.50, and then increases to $74.29. Average total cost, or ATC, equals total cost divided by quantity of output. ATC equals TC divided by Q, or average total cost equals the sum of average fixed cost and average variable cost. I suggest pausing the lecture and calculating average total cost. On a diagram, we can map out the average total cost curve. Costs are on the vertical axis and quantities on the horizontal. Average total cost starts at $170, decreases to $76, and then increases up to $88.57. We can put all of the cost curves together on one diagram. We can put all the cost curves on one diagram together. Average total cost is in green, average variable cost is in blue, average fixed cost is in dark blue, and marginal cost is in orange. Notice that the marginal cost curve intersects the average variable cost curve at its minimum and intersects the average total cost curve at its minimum. The average total cost curve is usually U-shaped. As quantity rises initially, average fixed costs pull average total costs down. Eventually, rising average variable costs pulls average total costs up. Efficient scale is the quantity that minimizes average total cost. Let's look at the relationship between average total cost and marginal cost. When marginal cost is less than average total cost is decreasing. When marginal cost is greater than average total cost is rising. This is why the marginal cost curve intersects the average total cost curve at the average total cost curve's minimum. Costs are different in the short run compared to the long run. The short run is a period of time in which some inputs are fixed, like the size of the factory or the amount of land a firm has. The costs of these inputs are fixed costs. The long run is a period of time in which all inputs are variable, meaning the firm can build more factories, sell existing ones, or purchase more land. There is not a fixed length of calendar time associated with the short run and the long run. The transition from the short run to the long run differs from firm to firm. In the long run, average total cost of any quantity is cost per unit using the most efficient mix of inputs.